Good morning. Welcome to Stockbridge Church and the Edinburgh Academy Carol Service for 2020. The special circumstances of this year mean that it's a service like no other. All our activities are being made available on the Edinburgh Academy YouTube channel instead of meeting together. We can't gather together in person, but we can still celebrate the presence of God in creation. This year has been a very different year, and I suppose we could say that every year, but this year has been more different than usual. Many changes have been forced upon us, many alterations to plans at school and in families, and particularly during the holiday season. I wish you every blessing as you share this service now. I wish you a good holiday break to follow it, but with you, I look forward to all the challenges that 2021 will bring us. Now join me in a prayer. Let us pray. Father, we gather to celebrate the gift of creation and life, and the gifts of your grace to us and all humankind. Help us to listen and hear the good news of your compassion and of Jesus Christ, the embodiment of your love and grace. Once again, we will hear the message of the prophets and the angels. We'll travel in heart and mind to Bethlehem, looking over the shoulders of shepherds and wise men, wondering once more at the birth of the child in the manger, Jesus Christ. Be with us, Father, as we hear from our readings the story of grace offered for all humanity. You made the world and you made us. Your creation is wonderful and it is good, but we are not always good. We can be wasteful and proud of our accomplishments. Help us to acknowledge our failures and then rejoice in the forgiveness that comes with the birth of this child. Help us to celebrate with hope and thanksgiving. Help us to be courageous in our joy and fearless in our living. We give thanks for all that continues to be done to care for the weak and the anxious, for the ill and the sorrowful. We pray for those who work in health and social care, for family and neighborly actions. And today we think especially of the work of life care here in Stockbridge. Local work, but their work also extends across the whole of Edinburgh, supporting and caring for the elderly. And we also remember Médecins Sans Frontières, who offer expert medical assistance and support in some of the world's most troubled areas. Lord, it's in the most challenging times that the best is brought out of our humanity and care for one another. And we give thanks for the skills and the resources you've given us and pray you help us to share them and use them well. Lord, hear our prayers. We offer them in the name of Jesus Christ. And now join him in prayer, using the words he taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Isaiah 9, 2, 6, and 7. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
Genesis 3, verse 8 to 19. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" He answered, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, so I hid." And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from?" The man said, "The woman you put here with me. She gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it. Then the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? The woman said, the serpent deceived me, and I ate. So the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and all wild animals. You will crawl on your belly, and you will eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. To Adam, he said, because you listened to your wife and ate fruit from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat from it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil, you will eat food from it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow, you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken. For dust you are, and to dust you will return.
Matthew 1, verses 18 to 25. This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and she gave him the name Jesus.
Luke 2, verses 1 to 7. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
Thank you. Luke 2, 8 to 20. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
Still proceeding, guide us to thy perfect will. Matthew 2, verses 1 to 12. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem, in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me, so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. They then opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route.
Yeah. John 1, verse 1 to 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
Thank you.
I once read the story of two men who were overheard when they were deep in conversation. The older of the two men was doing most of the talking. He was describing an enterprise in which he was interested, and he talked about its origins and its development, the current strategies, and the possible future of the business. But it left the young man puzzled. The story was interesting enough in its own way, but he wondered why he was being told it. It couldn't be for the sake of the story, and so he asked quite bluntly, "Why are you telling me all this?" And he got the equally blunt answer, "Because I'm hoping to persuade you to take a job with this firm." It was a story being told with a purpose. Well, Christmas is a story being told with a purpose. The Christmas story, as we know it, is found in only two books in the Bible, in the Gospel of Matthew and in the Gospel of Luke. And without the two chapters in each of these books which mention the events of Christmas, all of the familiar images of the Christmas story would be missing. There would be no wise men, no shepherds, no star, no angels, not even a manger scene. We're indebted then to Luke and Matthew for this story. But the details that we often think of as the Christmas story are actually not the point of the story at all. They wanted people to know the message of Jesus. They weren't so much telling the stories as asking for a response to the message of Jesus Christ. Now, like Matthew and Luke, I'm very happy to tell the story of Christmas, to repeat the stories that he told, the parables. But like them, I'm not telling them for fun. I'm telling them joyfully, but I'm telling them with a purpose. And the purpose is that they should bring us closer to God, and they should help us understand His purpose for our lives and for His world. We've organized this carol service this year in continuity with the services of past years, and we've heard the stories. We've shared the images of Christmas. We've listened to the familiar carols. And I hope you've sung along as well. But I'd be misleading you if I didn't make the point that this service, the words and the music, have a purpose. Their purpose is to point us towards what God has done and continues to do in the world. We tried holding the carol service here in the church some years ago, but we didn't fit. There were too many people. And with the present restrictions of COVID, we're actually now limited to just 50 people. So that's far short of the 1,000 who came to the service last time we held it. So we're limited this year. Just like there have been limitations at school, there are limitations on social life and family life, limits to traveling during the holiday season. These possibilities will return, and I hope soon. And perhaps we'll enjoy them all the more, because we'll know what it's like not to have freedom to do exactly what we want to do. We'll even be able to sing carols together. We've been brought back to basics, which to my mind is part of the point of the story of Christmas. Christmas should always bring us back to basics. We celebrate God's striking intervention into His creation. We celebrate His grace and His love for His people. That's the message of Christmas. It's not a sentimental appeal to be nice to others at this particular time of year. It's not to create a temporary feeling of goodwill. I share it to help people, you and me, to know our place in God's creation and to be inspired to live our lives to the full, not just 1 month a year, but 12 months of the year. I celebrate it so that we can together know our place in God's creation. We can celebrate our gifts and not just our presents. We share our lives and we cherish one another all the time and not just in the winter darkness. So it's not an appeal for you to become sentimental or to become religious. Jesus never told people to become sentimental or religious, but He did ask them to be thoughtful and thankful and joyful and generous. And whatever the limitations are in the COVID season, there's no limitation on being thoughtful and thankful and generous. I wish you a wonderful Christmas. Amen. Thank you for joining us for this service today. I wish you every blessing in the Christmas season and in the beginning of 2021 as it follows. And now may the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and the people you love, now and forever. Amen.